It's an invisible condition, and yet it's quite a destructive one if you don't look after yourself. There are three key features. The first one is that you have to have type 1 diabetes. So you can't have it if you haven't got diabetes. Don't really see it in type 2. The second is that you emit insulin at varying degrees. You might emit only a few units of insulin, or you might emit a whole dose, or you might omit it many times, you know. So that's the second key feature. And the third feature is that the reason why you omit insulin is that you have a fear that the insulin will cause weight gain.
Why do you use the word fear?
Because that's what it is. They are frightened that if I inject insulin, I will put on weight gain, because they will have experienced that.
Just how dangerous is diabulimia?
Well, it's really dangerous. I don't feel like I need to tell anybody with diabetes this, or any diabetes clinician this, but if you persistently omit the insulin that you should be taking, you're going to have constant high blood sugars, and they will be, whether you can see it or not, be damaging parts of your body inside. At the end of the day, you will die earlier. I mean, that's the sad bottom line. And you know, your family will lose you. You will never find out what you could have done with your life. So it's pretty serious.
It might be difficult to even conceive of a reason why someone would do that, like a
Because
motivation
it's
that
so
makes sense.
obviously wrong.
Right,
Yeah.
right.
But people smoke, then it's wrong. People drink too much, that's wrong. People eating too much. So we all engage in self-destructive behaviors. It is a sort of a human part of our, for some people, part of our human trait. Unless you're getting a signal to tell you that is big enough to make you change your behavior. So if you've got nobody telling you, I think you're not looking after yourself. So you're not getting an external signal that I'm really worried about you in a way that is supportive, and you're not getting an internal signal, i.e. pain, then it's very difficult to find that signal inside yourself that you must look after yourself now. So these people with diabulimia, they're not getting enough of a signal yet. They're not in pain. They're waiting until they get their first complication. Or I'll sort myself out in a few weeks. Or they've got this idea of what's called optimistic bias, which is they think it's not going to happen to them. That they're the ones, they understand that people get complications, but it's not going to happen to them. The reason why it appears to be more common in younger people is that it's during the adolescent phase, when you're becoming more and more independent with looking after your diabetes. And by the time you're hitting 14, 15, you are going through the adolescent phase of your life, which is where you are trying to work out who are you? You know, what is my who am I? What are my personality? What is it I like? What is it I don't like? What do people think of me? You know, that's a really important part of adolescence, is how you think other people perceive you. Do they think I'm a nice person, not a nice person? Do they think I'm fat, thin? Am I likable, lovable? You know, all of these questions you are raging inside you. And then put on top of that condition that you suddenly think, oh my goodness, I've got this condition that's with me. I really don't like it. It seems to be getting in the way of my life. Can't go out with my friends drinking without me having to worry about my diabetes. Can't fall in love with that boy or girl. What will they think about my diabetes? Will they like me with my diabetes? What will they think about me injecting? If you can drop diabetes, you would. And one way of doing it is by not injecting insulin. And in that process of not injecting insulin, you may discover or learn that you've lost a lot of weight. You've now got a tool. You will find a tool that says, well, actually, I can lose that weight. You and I might think that's really irrational. Pull yourself together. You need insulin to live. But from a person's point of view, that anxiety response can be quite disabling and distressing. When you have that fear of weight gain, in that mixture of thoughts and feelings is also the loathing that you have that you've got diabetes. Why me? Why do I, you know, this sort of burden that you feel. So that's all gets activated. So you can see how it could happen. It's like a toxic mix, isn't it? Until we get our head around how important a good, healthy mind is to the relationship that you have with your diabetes, you can give a person as much medicine as you want and as much technology as you want until they are happy, comfortable about having diabetes from a psychological point of view, you're not going to make much inroads. That's my perspective.